let's start this recap with the game of Alireza Firuja and Grigori Oparin. Alireza drew against Oparin and ended this tournament with a score of 8 out of 11, which is tremendous because he gained close to 12 ELO points. He became world number 4. He beat many strong players like Schweritz, Predke, Nayer, Shashikiran, Howell. And in spite of his loss to Caruana, he finished the tournament with 8 points out of 11, half a point clear of the entire field, and booking his first spot in the candidates at just the age of 18 years. It's simply tremendous what this youngster has achieved, and truly unbelievable. The second candidate spot went to Fabiano Caruana, because Caruana drew his game with Alexander Predke. And although Caruana reached on 7.5 points, the same score as Grigori Oparin, his tiebreak is better than Oparin, and that's the reason why he got the second spot. So Caruana and Firuja are two players who qualified to the candidates 2022. As for the Indian players, I think the final day was nothing extraordinary for them. Hari Krishna drew his game against Yuri Kuzubo. He didn't have too much of an advantage throughout the game, and overall, you know, he drew. For Hari Krishna, this tournament wasn't particularly great, but I think he managed to recover pretty well, and maybe he lost a few rating points, but roundabout he was very solid, scoring 6.5 points out of 11. Moving on, we had Nihal Sarin draw his final game against Daniel Dubov. Nihal was playing with the white pieces. Maybe he had a small advantage, but in the end, Daniel defended pretty well. Like here, Nihal is definitely slightly better, but the pieces were exchanged and then eventually the players agreed to a draw. For Nihal Sarin, I think this tournament was an amazing one. He managed to gain tangible rating points. He's now 2662 and also unbeaten. He beat Kirill Georgiev, Temur Kuibakorov, and drew with Fabiano Caruana, Pavel Ponkrato, Manuel Petrosian, David Navara, Gabriel Sargsyan, Parham Maksudlu, Diaz Bogdan, Fedosiev, and many top players. So great final result for Nihal Sarin. Moving on, we had Shashikiran, who was most likely the player of the tournament for India till a point, but lost his last two rounds. And I think at some point we were also expecting that he might even finish in top two in the tournament. He launched his pawns to the king side. However, this entire maneuver of bishop d8 to b6 was very classy by Korobov, and then black was taking over, you know, and Shashikiran did not manage to hold. Like here, after rook f2, he went rook f1, but knight f3 check came in and he had to give up his queen, because if king h1, there is rook f1, bishop f1, queen c3. If king h3, there is e5 check, and that is why black was totally winning and Anton Korobov beat Shashikiran. But for Shashi, I would say this has been a great event. He showed that, you know, he can fight with the best players in the world on kind of an equal footing, and this is how he did. He managed to gain few ELO points. He managed to even beat players like Vokidov, Fedosiev, Predke, Elyanov. So a great result for Shashi. The other Indian players, Arjun Erigesi, drew his game against Wojtaszek. I think Arjun was worse in this position with the black pieces, but Wojtaszek could not convert it. And then eventually the game ended in a draw here. For Arjun also, this was a very solid event. I think for Arjun, he lost two games and he won two games. So he scored 5.5, 50% score, and gained a couple of rating points. So, which is a good news for Arjun. Another game which was interesting was Raunak Sadwani versus Hans Niemann. He's still in progress. Just amazing that Raunak managed to get an equal position after being totally lost. So, somewhere around here, Raunak was losing because knight f2 check, rook f2, he was exchanged down. He exchanged the queens. And Niemann actually played this phase of the game very well by playing b4 takes and c2. Okay, here, basically the mistake came on rook takes here. If he had played d4, then he would have won the game, because after take, take, bishop f5, king g2, there is d3, takes and d2. And Niemann was winning completely. But this move, rook takes a2, turned to be a blunder. And then after knight f3, c2, and Raonic has managed to, you know, hold this. I think it'll end in a draw. He can even go knight f4 here and hold the game. So for Raonic, this event also was a pretty good one. He has been showing some great performance here. And if you look at the scorecard, Raonic has managed to gain few rating points, at the same time beaten players like Rakhmanov, Gukesh, Alexeyev. So all in all, a good show by the Nagpur youngster. Sethuraman has recovered pretty well from this event, and I think he's winning against Rakhmanov here. And I think Sethu got a slightly inferior position out of the opening, but slowly and steadily managed to turn the screws on the position. Like here, Black has plenty of compensation, but maybe slowly Rakhmanov lost the thread of the game. And here, yeah, White started to take over, and then Sethu started pushing his pawns. G5, takes, takes. Yeah, the king is very weak. And here, maybe queen e5 to h2, and then rook h8 could become very, very dangerous. So with this, Sethuraman, I think, might win. And for Sethu, the tournament didn't start so well, but I think has ended pretty well. I mean, he drew with many players and also beat Lucas Van Forest. And a 50% score is a good one. Today, the two youngsters faced off against each other, Gukesh and Pragnananda. I think Gukesh had a small edge in the position here. Maybe he had to go d5 here, but he went rook e1, and then eventually pieces got traded and the game ended in a draw. I think for both Pragnananda and Gukesh, this tournament would leave a lot to be desired, because if you see Prag, he beat Adiban, he beat Rauf Mamedov, but he then lost to Alexey Sarana, Ivan Saric, and also Savion Samuel. So he gained a couple of Elo points, while Gukesh here, he lost around 7 Elo points. And I think for Gukesh, it's been a long, long trip playing several events. In fact, when he was playing the Chess Super League, he was also playing in Armenia. So the youngster definitely is very, very tired after this huge trip. Meanwhile, Surya Ganguly lost his game to Chigayev Maxim. And I think Surya had a decent position. In fact, he was doing pretty well until some point. But then Maxim Chigayev started playing on the dark squares. And I think this h4. And slowly Surya got outplayed. Like queen came here. Knight came to g5. Bishop d7. This tactical blow came in. Because if you were to take queen takes e4, then there is this very interesting move, queen f2. And there is just no way to stop this mate on h2. It's a very tricky one, but it's a very nice tactic, knight e4. And very sharply spotted by Maxim Chigayev. So for Surya, this tournament also was a mixed bag. I think he played well overall, but in the end losing some Elo points. Did beat Budia Savlejevic and also Alexeyev, and has performed close to his rating. Adiban winning his last round against Normund Mises. Adiban had kind of an equalish position, but I think Mises went a little bit too far here. Like you can see here that Black was, I mean, White was better. But after, say, g5 takes, Black should have taken queen g5 with the threat of h4. But the moment he played h4, Adiban went g4 and king h3. Very nicely done. And here, you know, he took the h4 pawn and he managed to, you know, convert this into rook endgame. So for Adiban, I think this was maybe one of the most painful events of his chess career. But I think it's always such tough events which make you and into a tough character and also teaches you a lot. He has lost close to 24, 25 Elo points, and I think it has moved him out of the top 100 in the world ranking. But I think the beast will soon get married and play at the Tata Steel Chess India, and we'll be looking forward to, you know, him showing his true colors there. Moving to the women's section, we had Harika, who drew her game with Maria Muzichuk. I think it was around equal, and Harika, playing with Black, managed to, you know, play pretty solid chess, and in the rook end game she drew the game. So for Harika, this entire event has been fairly solid, and true to her style, she did not lose a single game In fact, she won 3 games and has managed to score 7 points out of 11, gaining 6 elo points. And I think it was a good performance. She could finish in top 8 and qualify for the Women's Grand Prix for the next cycle, I believe. She would have loved to finish first in the tournament. However, Le Tingyi was too strong. She scored a massive 9 points out of 11 with a performance of about 2700. And I think no one had chance in this event to catch her up. Vantika Agrawal, I would say, has been the absolute find of this event for India. And Vantika was playing Natalia Pogonina. Vantika scored her first IM nom in 9 games. And then in the remaining 2 games also, she's been super, super solid. And I think Vantika was slightly worse. Lost a pawn, but managed to hold it because of the opposite colored bishops. And that was really cool because I think 6.5 points in this tournament and gaining close to 50 ELO points is really amazing for Vantika. She moves to 2370 plus ELO. Only one loss to Alexandra Kostyanyuk, beating Divya, Lujan Carolina, Natalia Buxa, drawing with some legendary players. You know, like, this is a tremendous event and tremendous boost for Vantika Agrawal. Great, great play by her. And I think she is the player for India overall in this event. Vaishali lost her game to Alina Kashlinskaya. I think the position was okay. Rook A6 was played. And I think Vaishali gave away some material. But in the end, the king managed to run away to safety. And white won this. So I think Vaishali also played pretty well in this tournament. And she lost a couple of few rating points here. But good experience for Vaishali. She beat Kamaladinova and Alina Bivol in this event. Divya lost her game to Elena Danelian. And the position was already worse out of the opening for Divya. In fact, this position was okay. She pushed her pawn to b3, and I think that led to her downfall. The pawns were too weak, and then slowly Elena Danelian managed to convert this into a win. And Divya scored 4 points in this event out of 11. She lost around 6, 7 to 8 elo points. Fought hard, I think, learned a lot. She had 3 wins. I think one against Jovanka Huska would be one that she will remember from this event as a positive experience. And lastly, we had Padmini Raut, who lost her game today to Mary Arabidze. Padmini was slightly worse, but her opponent slowly, managed to convert this with the black pieces. And yeah, the king is too weak, and it's going to get checkmated very soon with queen a8 and queen a6. So Padmini lost this. I think she was one of the players who had many good positions in this tournament, but they didn't go her way, and she overall lost some 5 to 6 elo points, but beat Pia Kramling, Vaishali and Ezugi Ueri. 4 points for her. So that was the overall roundup from the tournament. We had Firuja number 1, Caruana number 2 qualifying for the candidates. Top 8 spots in the open section go to the FIDE Grand Prix as well. And we also had Le Tingyi qualifying for the women's candidates, 1 spot. So congratulations to all of them. Indian players fought very hard. I hope you enjoyed the commentary. I did the commentary on all the days. There was roundup every day. So if you liked it, please do like this video.